Good evening. Welcome to the Monrovia City Council meeting for Tuesday, June 4th, 2013. This evening, we will have our invocation by our police chaplain, Terrence Brown, and a council member, Larry Spicer, will lead us in the pledge.
Let us pray. O Lord, once again we come before you in the spirit of praise and thanksgiving. Thank you for the wonderful liberties that you have so graciously bestowed upon us. The liberty to serve in positions where we can be of great benefit to this community, where our collective experience and expertise can be utilized to provide effective, innovative solutions to address and solve our city's challenges. I pray a special blessing upon our mayor, city council members, and entire city staff that you will continue to lead them with your love, guide them with your wisdom, speak to them with your understanding, encourage them with your grace, overshadow them with your peace, and empower them with your strength. Strength to do, strength to encourage, and strength to uplift. In your glorious name I pray, amen.
Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance to our flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
May we have roll call, please.
Council members Adams.
Here.
Blackburn.
Here.
Spicer.
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem Shevlin.
Here.
And Mayor Lutz.
Present. Can we have a report of the closed session, please?
Thank you, Mayor. Good evening. Prior to the meeting this evening at 6:30, the council met in closed session regarding the three items on the posted agenda. There were two matters of existing litigation, the Lopez case detailed on the agenda and the Cobb case detailed on the agenda, as well as a matter of labor negotiations. The council took reports from staff and took no reportable action.
Thank you. This evening, we do have some very special proclamations and presentations, and we're going to start this evening with a very special proclamation to a group of residents and people who come to our city who are members of the Sushi Foundation. It came to our attention that Sushi USA was honored by the president at the White House for the efforts that they gave. And I want to tell you a little bit about this honor. On April 24th, they were honored by the president as a champion for change. This is a program that was created to recognize individuals and groups who do extraordinary things to empower and inspire members of their communities. In particular, the White House was honoring groups and individuals who came out in support of Hurricane Sandy. And our organization, Sushi, was one of the organizations that came and helped after Hurricane Sandy. Let me tell you a little bit about what they did. They responded to the earthquake in 2012. It happened October, November, as we all recall. They provided aid and materials such as hot food and blankets and emergency financial assistance, totaled almost $10 million. They have organized almost 60,000 people, and in more than 25 different disasters, they have helped out. And most recently, they provided emergency cash debit cards to the people in Waco, Texas, who were devastated by the fertilizer plant explosion. So they have gone above and beyond and were even helpful at the Boston Marathon disaster. So I would like to ask, we have a representative from Sushi who's going to talk to us for a couple of minutes, and then we have a recognition we would like to give them and congratulate them on this very special honor, but mostly thank them for the things they do, not just for our community here, but for our country and the world. So I'm not sure who's going to speak. Okay, why don't you come to the microphone if you would, please.
Good evening.
Mayors and the city councils and the ladies and the gentlemen. My name is Elaine Lin. It's my honor to represent Ciji to be here to receive the recognition from City of Monrovia. And we are so glad that we are the residents of here in City of Monrovia. We are here for about, I think it's more than 20 years, right? Uh-huh. Our first headquarter in United States is in Monrovia. We start from here. And now we also have our preschool, elementary school, and also the Ciji academies here in this lovely and friendly educational environment. You know, like the waiting list for our preschool is more than 100. And you know, the most comments is because our schools provide a safe environment, safe and lovely environment. I think that's not because our school, right? It's because we are here in City of Monrovia, and we include all the community, like the park, the library, and everything that give our children a very, very happy and nurturing education environment. As Mayor mentioned, that we help Hurricane Sandy, that Ciji's spirit and our principle is very, very simple. Wherever there's need, we are there. So when Hurricane Sandy happened, we are there. Not only in United States, we also help Haiti, we help Japan, we help everywhere. When there's anywhere, there's disaster, and the Ciji people will be there. And we are not only there for just 10 days, 3 months. We are there for almost like we have the short-term, mid-term, and a long-term helping plan to help the people to have a more stable environment to live. So that's our goal. And our core value of Ciji, gratitude, respect, and love. And that our Master Zheng Yan teaches us, we giving is our meaningful of the life, and we should give without asking for any returns. And Dharma Master Zheng Yan is a Buddhist nun from Taiwan. She founded the Ciji Foundation in 1966. In the beginning, it's just a 30 family housewife, and now in the globally, we have so many supporters, and we are so happy that we can get the recognition from the City of Monrovia, and also we are so happy that we can get the White House, the champions of change. So it's really our honor, it's really our pleasure, and I think that we will continue doing doing our best to help people get rid of the sufferings, and we are continuing to support the community and all the United States. Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you. Congratulations. Now, as Elaine said, they have been in Monrovia for many, many years, and I'm very fortunate to have had the opportunity to be with you on several occasions and to witness some of the work that you do. But a lot of our residents maybe do not know all that you do. For example, you make these wonderful blankets that you give out, and you have food, that this rice product that can be given out when there's disasters that can feed people and things like that. I know you have a video that will explain to anybody really what you do and kind of highlights the giving and the generosity that you have. What we're going to do is our city manager has a weekly newsletter. She's going to put the link to this video on her newsletter so that we can share that information with anybody who wants to know a little bit more about what you do, because it is such a wonderful, wonderful experience to know what the giving that your organization gives.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. So we have a resolution or a recognition for you. I'm going to read it to you, and then we're all going to come down, take a picture, and I think you would like your whole group in this picture. We would like that. Sushi USA, recipient of the 2013 White House Champion of Change Award, in recognition of their dedication in supplying practical assistance and giving tirelessly of their energy, their resources to people in need during Hurricane Sandy, the Waco fertilizer plant explosion, as well as the Boston Marathon bomb explosion. Their involvement in enhancing and impacting the lives of others around the world is also working to make a difference here in our local communities. And we'd like to present this to you. So we're all going to come down. Our next item is a proclamation, and I am going to let Daryl Brooks speak on behalf of the YMCA. No, it's not Daryl. It'll be Rebecca Romero, and then she will bring up Daryl Brooks. I'm going to turn this over to Rebecca to explain this. And she's bringing a big group of people with her. We go with the flow here.
Good evening, Mayor Lutz and members of the City Council. I am here on behalf of Memo Chavez because he is very busy with summer extravaganza registration. So I'm excited to be involved with this Youth Commission and TAB members tonight. But we are here in partnership with the YMCA. Daryl Brooks will explain what we've partnered with the YMCA. We're very excited. And at the end of the presentation, our youth commissioners and TAB members are here to assist the YMCA and Daryl Brooks in accepting the proclamation. So I'm going to turn it over to Daryl Brooks.
Thank you, Rebecca. Madam Mayor, members of City Council, staff, people in attendance tonight, we have decided to take a track with regard to the health and well-being of our community. As you may know, I'm one of the Board of Managers of the San Anita YMCA, but more importantly, I'm the chairperson of the Healthy Living Council of the San Anita YMCA. And for us, healthy living is more than just exercise. You can Zumba in the street with me for the Fountains of the Fall, and I've seen you. I've seen you in action, some of you out there. But it's more than that. You have to adopt a diet that's going to be healthy and increase your lifespan. So we have adopted a sugar-free summer program for everyone in the city of Monrovia. Now, some cities adopt a one book, one city approach to increase literacy in the community. I am proposing a one city, no soda proposal here in Monrovia for the summertime. And our goal is to have everyone to increase their health and wellness by doing away with sugary or any kind of sodas for the entire summer. It's a pretty easy program, but I need to have everyone's support with this. So members of City Council, Madam Mayor, members of the audience, members of the people at home on television, I cordially invite you to take the pledge with me and take charge of your health. So please, repeat after me. I pledge to.
I want to do this right now.
Be soda free. Keep my family healthy by reducing sugary drinks at home.
Keep my family healthy by reducing sugary drinks at home.
Help make my community a place with healthy beverage choices.
Help make my community healthy beverage choices.
Congratulations, you are taking the pledge to have a soda-free summer in Monrovia.
Okay.
I mean, for those who are, hide that one, Councilman Adams.
I don't know how I got here.
For those who are religious and have those kind of backgrounds, it's like going through Lent. It's okay to, do away with something, especially in the summertime when it's so hot and you want to reach for something that's really cold. I think we can try to do this in a really healthy way so that come next Fountain of Falls, everybody in the community will be joining me and dancing in the streets with Zumba. So I thank you all for your attendance and I appreciate your inspiration to us all. Thank you.
Thank you. And now I believe our Youth Commission and Tab have something. Okay, great.
I'm Elizabeth Schneider, and I'm a librarian at the Monrovia Public Library and supervisor of the Teen Advisory Board. So I'd like to introduce the Tab members. We've got Jesus Galen Alvila. I'm sorry. And Megan Matison, who is our middle school president. And for Youth Commission
tonight, we have Taylor Blackwell and Stephen Garcia. And Taylor is actually going to say a few words to the council.
We look forward to making the summer a soda-free summer, and we'll be sure to pass along this information to our fellow youth commissioners and TAB members.
Okay, very good. Thank you. We have a proclamation that we're going to present to everybody from the YMCA and the TAB and the youth commissioners. Let me just let everybody know what it says here. The City of Monrovia, whereas the Santa Anita Family YMCA and the City of Monrovia Community Services and Public Works Departments, there's a typo on here, so we'll have to correct it, are partnering to organize a regional soda-free summer campaign, or including the communities of Arcadia, Duarte, and Monrovia, which are the service areas that our YMCA serves. Whereas the American Academy of Pediatrics recommends eliminating soft drinks from schools, and the American Dental Association recommends limiting soda intake. And whereas the prevention of diabetes and obesity are among the most urgent health challenges of our day, and whereas studies have shown that an association between being overweight and soft drink consumption and a threefold increase in soda consumption among youth between 9 and 19 years of age predicts an increase in body mass index and a decrease in dietary calcium. And whereas women who drink soda or sweetened fruit drinks every day are more likely to develop type 2 diabetes, and an African American or Latino born today has a 50% chance in developing type 2 diabetes. And whereas soda is the largest source of added sweeteners for children, and reducing intake of added sugars, especially sugar-sweetened beverages, may be helpful in achieving recommended nutrient intakes and weight control. Whereas 53% of adults in Monrovia, Duarte, and Arcadia are overweight or obese, and approximately 21% of children and teens in grades 5, 7, and 9 are obese. And whereas the YMCA and the City of Monrovia are committed to preventing chronic disease, now therefore I, Marianne Lutz, Mayor of the City of Monrovia, along with the entire City Council, do hereby proclaim June, July, and August of 2013 as soda-free summer in Monrovia, and urge all Monrovias to rethink your drink and Go Soda Free This Summer, dated June 4th, 2013. And we would like to come present this to you. Finally, this evening, this is a bittersweet proclamation. You know, every year, we have a representative from our high school sit with us and talk to us about what's happening at the high school. And I have to say, we really hit the jackpot this year when Sela Rich was our representative. Sela's done an outstanding job communicating to us and to all of our residents what's going on at the high school, telling us even little stories about how you work with things. It's been very, very, very good, and we appreciate your time and your ability to share that information with everybody. But now, sadly for us, I don't think she's so sad, Sela will be graduating tomorrow. And she will be going off to college next year. Now, did you make a decision?
I did. I am going to Belmont University in Nashville, Tennessee.
Very nice. Yeah. Good decision. So, yes. So it's time for us to say thank you and goodbye. But you'll be back. You're not leaving us for good. I know that your heart will always be part of Monrovia. But we have a little recognition for you, and it reads, the City of Monrovia presents to Sela Rich for a year of outstanding in-depth reporting and commitment to excellence as student liaison to the City Council 2012-2013. Thank you for a very well done job.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sela. And we're all going to come down and give this to you. So now, as right on cue, Sela will give us her final report.
Yes, and thank you to all of you for letting me be up here and present to you every other week. It was a very good experience for me as well. We have a lot of congratulations in order this week, but first we want to wish a good luck to our underclassmen taking finals this week. Their last day is Thursday. We wish them all a very happy and wonderful summer. Congratulations to our seniors who officially checked out of high school last Thursday, May 30th, and then proceeded to go to grad night at Six Flags until 5 a.m. that next morning, on Friday morning. We returned to the high school at 6:30 a.m. and slept all day Friday. Congratulations to all seniors who received scholarships last night at our senior awards night, and thank you to all the contributors and organizations who provided the scholarships for our seniors. Congratulations to Canyon Oaks High School, who is actually having their commencement ceremonies right now. Congratulations to those. I think there's about 75 of them graduating tonight. And as you said, Monrovia High School's commencement ceremony is tomorrow night at 7 o'clock at Monrovia High School, and we would just wish all of our seniors the best of luck. Thank you again.
Thank you very much. And we do wish you the best of luck as well.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, Ms. Lyle, do we have any changes to the order of the business?
No, we don't have any changes this evening, ma'am.
Okay, then we will move on with our consent calendar.
Move to approve.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Thank you. This passes. And the next portion of our agenda is our public comment period. This is the time when anybody who would like to speak to this council on any item that is not currently on the agenda may do so. All you need to do is fill out a blue speaker card and our city clerk will call your name. Ms. Atkins.
Nikki Conway.
I'm nervous, so I'm going to read. Hi, Mayor Letts and the school board. My name is Nikki Conway. And how many of you have had the opportunity to visit the completely renovated Louise K. Taylor Performing Arts Center located on the Monrovia High School campus? Anybody? No, nobody? Okay. Well, it's very beautiful. Yeah. It's a beautiful theater with a renovated auditorium and stage and a state-of-the-art sound and lighting systems. I'm here with an exciting announcement. The Louise K. Taylor Performing Arts Center, under the Director of Performing Arts, Patrick Garcia, will be presenting a production of The Music Man this summer on July 18th, 19th, and 20th. And the play will be presented, even though it's being presented at Monrovia High School, it is not a high school production. It's a professional theater production for the community of Monrovia. Now, I don't know about you, but my husband and I, we love to go to the theater. We go to the theater a lot, but we usually have to go to Pasadena, Los Angeles, wherever we can get it. But it's nice that the theater and arts are going to come to Monrovia, and we're hoping that in the future it's going to be something where a lot more people utilize this. What's also nice, too, is when the theater draws a crowd, and, you know, the theater holds 1,700 people, it's going to be nice for the city of Monrovia and the businesses and the restaurants because, you know, when you go to a play, you want to eat, you want to drink, well, and, you know, and just enjoy yourself. I know I do. Okay. There's going to be a banner advertising The Music Man on Myrtle Avenue. There's also going to be a table at the Friday Night Festival, so if you're interested in sponsoring on the playbill or advertising, or you want to buy tickets, or you just want more information, you can contact Julia Clegg at Monrovia Unified School District, and her phone number is 626-471-2032. I have flyers for the play, and you can also order the tickets online at brownpapertickets.com. And we're just hoping that this is going to be something exciting for Monrovia, a future of the appreciation of the arts. But there's more, and then I'll wrap it up. The Louise K. Taylor Performing Arts Center is planning to present a series of plays. Plans are underway to present a production of White Christmas the first week of December, and the entire theater seasons at the Louise K. Taylor Performing Arts Center in the years to come. Well, The Music Man is the first of many planned productions, and I hope to see all of you there. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you.
Anne Levine.
Hello. I'm not really used to talking to a lot of people, so I'm kind of nervous. My heart is with animals, especially dogs and cats and companion animals. And I know that Monrovia has a budget problem, and I think they can save a lot of money by finding creative ways to deal with all the dogs and cats that people don't want. I think they can do things with education, And I did bring an article for the council to read. I'm sorry it's so small. That's the only way they could get it when I went to make a copy. But most animals in the shelters today, once upon a time, were someone's pet, at least 75%. And if people would keep their commitments to their animals, then the shelters, the shelters would be empty. And if people would neuter and spay and be responsible for their animals, then there wouldn't be all these kittens coming, everywhere that, they're cute, they're wonderful. The puppies are wonderful and cute. Crazy to say that the way you deal with unwanted animals is to kill them. That just doesn't make sense. There has to be a better way to deal with it. So I have this article, and there was another article I forgot to bring, but I have this one, and if you have any questions, then you have my contact number from the...
Great. Ms. Atkins will make copies of that for us, or you have copies for us.
She'll I have copies for you, yes.
Great. Thank you very much. There are no other speaker cards at this moment. Is there anybody else who would like to speak to this council on any item that is not currently on the agenda? If so, you may come forward. Seeing and hearing none, we will close this portion of our agenda, and we will move on to our first public hearing. This is public hearing number one, an appeal of a Historic Preservation Commission's decision regarding property at 535 West Lemon Avenue. And Craig Jimenez, our planning division manager, will lead us in this report. Mr. Jimenez, before you begin, under direction from our city attorney, I believe that some of the council members may have met with the property owner and have viewed the property, and so I think we need to go through and disclose if we have done that.
I would suggest we do that when we get to the public hearing portion. So we
okay, when I open the public hearing?
Yeah.
All right, we'll do it then. Thank you.
Yeah. Good evening, Mayor and members of the City Council. The property at 535 West Lemon Avenue was recently purchased. Initially, the property owner had intended to restore the house. However, as he got further into the process, he discovered that the structure would require substantially more repairs and improvements than originally anticipated, and does not believe that the restoration is economically but feasible option, and has submitted a demolition permit. Since the house was built prior to 1940, the property is subject to the city's demolition ordinance. The house is also on the city's list of potential landmarks. The Historic Preservation Commission reviewed the demolition permit at their April meeting, and using the California Historic Resource Status Codes, the commission assigned a rating of 5S3, which indicates that, in their opinion, the house would qualify as a historic landmark. And although the commission's review is advisory only, their determination has some ramifications for the future development, primarily under the California Environmental Quality Act, or CEQA. The property owner has filed an appeal of the determination to the City Council. The house and the property have a long history and have gone through several substantial modifications. Originally, the house was built in 1888. In 1901, it was substantially basically demolished. A portion of it was kept, and a new Victorian era house was two-story house was built. In the late 50s, the original porch was removed and replaced with a colonial revival facade. And this is looking at the front facade. The most significant change to the house was the removal of the original porch and the construction of this colonial revival facade. And kind of interesting story about this is that these large columns that are in front were actually salvaged from former movie star Marion Davies' beach house in Santa Monica. The owner brought them here and incorporated them into the remodel. The facade does have a very distinct design features of a colonial revival. However, it is just on the facade. As you turn the corner, this is on the east elevation, you can see the difference between the facade and then the original Victorian portion of the house. The wide plank siding, narrow gauge siding, the windows are definitely have a Victorian flavor to them. And then if you look further here, there's another addition, stucco sided, that was done sometime perhaps at the 50s when the facade was put on. And this is looking at the west side, and again you can see the kind of the juxtaposition between the facade here, and then you've got a bay element that's very typical of Victorian on the side elevation. The Historic Preservation Commission's role was focused on the existing structure, evaluating the historic value and architectural integrity, not future development. In this application, the Historic Preservation Commission has three roles: the review of the potential landmark, review of the demolition permit, and the evaluation and assignment of a rating code using the California Historic Resource Status Codes. In 1995, the City Council adopted a resolution establishing a list of potential landmarks. Potential landmarks are defined as structures with the highest possibility of qualifying for designation under the City's Historic Preservation Ordinance. However, just being on the potential list does not grant or guarantee designation. Each listed property still has to submit an application and go through the process. Under the provisions of the Monrovia Municipal Code, the Historic Preservation Commission has advisory review over modifications and demolitions on properties on the potential landmark list. This review allows the Commission to provide assistance and guidance to owners on an advisory basis. In 2004, the Neighborhood Compatibility Ordinance was adopted to address concerns about new development in existing neighborhoods. These provisions added a new review of demolition permits for houses built before 1940, and this review is done by the Historic Preservation Commission. In keeping with the voluntary nature of the city's Historic Preservation Ordinance, the Commission does not approve or deny demolition. Part of the process also includes the rating of the structure, and again, it's to provide guidance to the property owner. And while this review is advisory only, the assignment of a 5S3 status code has impact for future development under the California Environmental Quality Act. Consistent with most jurisdictions in the state and historic preservation protocol, Monrovia uses the California Historic Resource Status Codes as a way to provide a uniform system for historic resources and also to be consistent with state regulations, including CEQA. Status codes range from 1 to 6, with 1 having the highest level of significance and 6 being the lowest. Pursuant to CEQA, any property that's rated between 1 and 5 is considered to have some level of historic significance. One of the key factors of evaluating significance is the structure's integrity. A property's integrity is its ability to convey or to communicate its significance and its historic value. And generally speaking, historic properties either retain their integrity or they don't. They do not. The California Environmental Quality Act plays a more important role now in the review of historic resources. And the meaning and importance of the status code and in terms of terms like potential landmark has changed over time. State law and case law have both evolved to provide much greater protection to structures that are rated, either as part of a survey or individually. One of the primary changes has been in CEQA, and the definition of historic resources under CEQA is classified as a structure or property that has a rating of 1 through 5. What this means is that as part of the review of future development, the potential effects on the resource must be considered. This would include demolition. And since courts have determined that there is no way to mitigate demolition of a historic resource, the environmental review under CEQA for a future project would likely be an environmental impact report. The Historic Preservation Commission had an extensive and very thoughtful discussion regarding the property's significance, which focused primarily on criteria number 5 of the Historic Preservation Ordinance. The municipal code defines criterion number 5 as a property that has a unique location or physical characteristics or represents an established and familiar feature of a neighborhood, community, or city. The discussion amongst the commissioners also included previous occupants, architecture, the neighborhood, and the condition of the house. The commission voted to assign a rating code of 5S3 to the property, which means that they felt that it meets the level of significance required for historic designation. The property owner has filed an appeal to the decision for the consideration by the City Council. The appeal letter was attached to the staff report and describes his reasoning for the reconsideration of the decision by the commission. A home inspection report was also completed, which estimates rehabilitation costs of approximately $200,000, which was also part of your staff report. The following options are presented to the City Council tonight for your consideration. One would be to deny the appeal and to uphold the Historic Preservation Commission's determination that the house should be rated as 5S3. The other option would be to uphold the appeal, overturning the Historic Preservation Commission's rating and assign a rating code of 6L. So that concludes my presentation. I would be happy to answer any questions, and the property owner is also here.
Greg, can you tell us what the S3 and the L indicate?
Sure. 5S3, anything in the fives has to do with local designation. 5S3 means that it has been determined that this property would qualify as a landmark. When a property goes from being determined as being eligible to actually being designated, it goes from an 5S3 to a 5S1. So 5S1 means designation, and 5S3 means eligible. The 6L is anything in the sixes is considered not to have historic significance. There are two general categories that we use in the sixes. One is a 6L and one is a 6Z. 6Z means there really is no historic value in there. Assigning a 6L says that there's something about the house, although it doesn't quite reach that level of significance to be a landmark, that special consideration in the planning process can be granted, such as variances. And that was a very important component when we went to the neighborhood compatibility ordinance to provide incentives for people to save houses that may not meet the landmark, but it would be nice to see the property saved. So that 6L basically provides a finding for the Planning Commission or the City Council to approve an exception or variance from the development standards. The project over on the 200 block of Olive, where they saved the one house and built the 3 on the PUD, is an example of a property that they use those incentives, and that existing house was assigned to 6L.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions of staff? I have a question, Greg, about a couple of things. Based on these ratings and the staff report, one of the things that I'm curious about that I didn't see in the report is if this house was offered up for a Mills Act, would it qualify?
They did not apply for a landmark status, and you have to be a landmark, and then you can qualify for a Mills Act. That's a benefit of being a landmark. They would have to go through the process of being designated a historic landmark, and then they can also apply for a Mills Act. So that was not what was requested.
Yeah, I understand that. Based on our criteria, though, of whether a property is eligible to be designated as a Mills Act, would this property qualify?
Yes, and the Historic Preservation Commission gave it the 5S3, meaning that they felt, in their opinion, it was eligible to qualify.
And would staff have made that recommendation?
That was not our recommendation going to the commission. We were recommending a 6L based on the lack of integrity.
So can you talk a little bit more about the recommendation you made as staff and why you made that recommendation?
Staff made a recommendation to the Historic Preservation Commission that the property, while is certainly people are very familiar with the property. Because of all of the modifications that have been done to that property over the years, including the removal of the facade and replacing it with a new facade, we felt that it didn't really convey that integrity needed to communicate whatever the historic significance of the property was, whether it was identified with a particular architect or whether it was identified with someone who lived in the past. It is sort of an esoteric term, but integrity, when a property doesn't have that integrity, let me give you an example of the Monroe House. William Monroe was very prominent, certainly significant in the history of Monrovia. Had the house been completely remodeled and William Monroe came and looked at it today, and would he recognize that house as being his? And if it was completely remodeled, he may not. Then it loses its integrity. It loses its ability to convey that significance. So we looked at this property kind of the same way. It had been modified so much and had so much deferred maintenance that it really impacted the integrity of the structure. So that's where staff was coming from.
Thank you. Any other questions?
I don't have a question.
Just one other. On that stucco, was that an addition that was stuccoed? Was that an existing room that was stuccoed over? Do you know?
It was added on at some point. It wasn't part of the original 1901.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. All right.
Craig?
Did they have stucco in 1901?
No.
A different kind of stucco. Okay.
Thank you.
Wasn't there more than one addition, though, on the back of the house?
There was multiple additions and changes,
right.
and there was the
roof lines in the back. The eaves were all very different. But that one room, the one that with the picture with the big plate glass, is that even to code? It does not even.
That's a good question. We did not evaluate it as far as building codes, and the permit history on this property is spotty at best.
In its current condition, I mean, if someone were to want to do restore the home or something, and the city went out there to look at it, at the condition it is now, would it be to code, or do you know?
I don't know. That's not really my expertise. But visually, I certainly would have some concerns about it.
Okay.
And I know that the owner did hire a home inspector to look at that and looked at some of the structural issues.
I noted that it said 200,000. Was that just to make it habitable? I would doubt very seriously that would be the price to restore it.
That my understanding is that's to make it habitable. Someone could live in,
and
there's problems with the electrical and.
That's what the document says, is to make it habitable. Any other questions? I have one more, just a timing question. The staff report said the application to demolish was filed on April 1st, and the Planning Commission reviewed on April 24th. Is the 120 days that the applicant would be waiting start April 1st or April 24th?
It starts April 1st. So the date that the permit is filed, that starts the clock ticking.
Okay. And 120 days from there would be? You don't know?
August? Actually, July 30th, I believe.
July 30th? Okay.
However, we cannot, per our code, we cannot issue a demolition permit until a building permit for new construction is ready to issue. So they're done concurrently. We don't, per the demolition ordinance, we can't issue a demolition permit until they're ready to start construction.
Oh, okay.
And that's where CEQA kicks in, because now that demolition is part of any future development and has to be evaluated through it environmentally.
But should the applicant have plans for development, they will have to go through CEQA.
Right. There would.
Anyway, regardless.
Right. Generally, with a residential development, it would be exempt. Under CEQA, unless it's a very, very large project, usually smaller projects, single family up to, probably 20 units, if there was determined to be no significant impacts, fall under a categorical exemption.
So the fact that this is in this category is what triggers the CEQA?
Right, because the demolition now of this structure that was determined by the commission to have some significance now has to be evaluated as part of it.
Okay, and should this council uphold the historic commission's ruling, CEQA will take effect? If this council declines their ruling, CEQA does not take effect?
Then if the council chooses to uphold the Historic Preservation Commission's decision that the house has some significance, then any future development will have to take into consideration to be part of the environmental review the demolition of that structure in addition to the development that's following. So that becomes a component. If the commission overturns the Historic Preservation Commission's decision and upholds the appeal and determines that the house gives it a 6L rating, so the house, in your opinion, does not qualify as a historic landmark, then CEQA now becomes a non-issue because it's not in that 1-5 range.
Okay, great.
But just to be clear, CEQA would always apply. It's just a different level of review
or
evaluation that kicks in with the 5 designation as opposed to the 6.
Okay.
But CEQA is always in effect as to the problem.
Okay. There are no other questions. I'm going to open the public hearing. And to start with, per our city attorney's recommendation, I'm going to ask council members if they have had a discussion or about this property to please do some disclosing at this time.
Okay. I did meet with the applicants, Mr. Seidner, and went to the property and looked at it and left. That's my disclosure.
Thank you.
I had the opportunity to meet with the applicant and went to the property and viewed the property.
I did meet with the applicant, and I've been at this property many, many, many times over the past couple of decades.
Okay. Mr. Spicer,
did you? No, I didn't.
You're not. I need to disclose that I as well met with the applicant and did view the property interior and exterior. So
yes, I saw the interior as well.
All righty. So now with the public hearing, we will begin. I have one speaker card, Pat Orlando.
Good evening, Mayor Lutz and members of the City Council and members of the Monrovia community. My home is directly behind 535 West Lemon, this development, excuse me, and I just wanted to express my concern that I don't want the value of my property to be adversely affected by whatever the new owner's plans are for this property, if the house should get demolished. And if the house remains, I also wanted to note that one of the trees on his property is pushing up against the brick wall that separates our property and affecting that structure, and needs to be corrected. And that's all I had to say. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. I do not have any other speaker cards.
Mayor, I should suggest that as a public hearing on an application, we should hear from the applicant, give them the opportunity to be heard, whether or not they have a card, and also the opportunity to speak after public speakers if there are any.
Okay, great. Did the applicant wish to speak?
Good evening, Mayor Lutz, council members. My name is Steve Seidner. I've been a resident of Monrovia for 25 years. I also owned a business in town for several years. I really love and appreciate the history and the value of the history here in Monrovia. There's been two homes that I purchased in the last year, or actually in the last 18 months. One of them was a home at 511 Wild Rose. It was a home that was built in 1911. This home was in disrepair, and there were numerous violations from the city. There were expired permits, unmaintained exterior, defective roof, and several other items. All these items I repaired within 30 days on that home. Another home was 411 East Colorado, was on the verge of losing its Mills Act. I repaired all the items that were incomplete from the Mills Act, and these were all done within 45 days. So certainly I see the value and appreciate the value of the old homes in Monrovia. When I first looked at the home on Lemon Avenue, the first thought was I was going to repair that home also. But after numerous meetings with city staff, contractors, and a variety of other folks, it was determined it was beyond repair. The house, the disrepair in that house is really unbelievable, as most of you have seen. And it's not feasible for repair. As Craig said, there's numerous updates or repairs that have been done to the house and additions, and there's no permits on file. What I'm asking for is the staff's recommendation was that the house lacks architectural integrity to convey significance to qualify as a local historic landmark. So what I'm requesting is that the city council agree with staff's original recommendation of a 6L. I can answer any questions.
I had asked, or you had commented, I believe that you had offered, or you would offer, if the house is demolished, that you would make sure that any item that could be salvaged would be made available for salvage purposes, such as the main columns in the front and any other historic worthy piece of wood or hardware or anything like that.
Absolutely. I made that comment at the historic committee meeting, and I'll make that tonight, that anything of historic value that a committee member or anyone of the town wants, they're more than welcome to have it.
Any other questions?
Yeah, Mr. Snyder, this isn't the complete inspection sheet, is it? It's just this inspection sheet?
The home inspector?
Right.
No, it's 30 pages.
Right, I know. I was just wondering. No, that's all. That's all.
Okay. Anybody else have any other questions for Mr. Seidner? All right. Thank you. And now, is there anybody else who would like to speak to this item at the public hearing?
Mayor Lutz, members of the City Council, staff, and Monrovians, my name is Steve Baker, and I come before you this evening in my role as city historian and as the voice of an old house. On February 9, 2013, the Monrovia City Council, responding to the Plan Monrovia process, set the city's top six priorities over the next 5 years. One of the six was historic preservation. Maintain our commitment to historical stewardship by preserving historic homes, structures, sites, and districts with sensitivity to neighborhood context. I believe that an application of this priority is the house at 535 West Lemon Avenue. Admittedly, it is a structure reflecting a considerable amount of deferred maintenance. It has mechanical systems of needed replacement. It has also had several inappropriate additions and modifications. I understand that. But the house is part of Monrovia's heritage, and I believe it deserves to be preserved. It was built for the Hutchins family, associated with our city for 115 years, and lived in by the Ellingson family, associated with Monrovia for nearly as long. In 2007, the property at 214-216 North Encinitas was threatened with demolition. As a pre-1940 structure, it came before the Historic Preservation Commission for advisory review. After considering the unique nature of the property and its construction by the Tiffel brothers, noted local builders, the commission voted to assign a status code that would uphold a 120-day waiting period before demolition and possibly trigger the California Environmental Quality Act. During that waiting period, a local preservation-minded couple decided to purchase the property from the owners, save it from demolition, and restore it. The property is now a local landmark. I was present at the Historic Preservation Commission meeting on April 24th, and I spoke before the commission, stating my strong belief that 535 West Lemon is a structure worth preserving because of its unique character and its associations with families prominent in the life of Monrovia. It is truly a one-of-a-kind of Monrovia. Demolishing it will diminish the variety of our local housing stock. I was impressed with the diligence the commission displayed in reviewing the proposed demolition, considering the options, and fulfilling their mission. It was not an easy process for them. In the course of my remarks to the Historical Preservation Commission, I shared the following response from preservationist Bronson Pinchot to a reporter's question. Your passion on your show is so much about the old being better than the new. Why is that so important? And his response, because the old has got the soul of everyone who's ever touched it and lived in it. So it means that a house from 1820 or 1840 or 1780 has all the children that slid down the banister. That's in the grain of the wood. And it's profoundly meaningful. People often say that when they go to a house, when they know who lived there, Monticello or Mount Vernon, they feel something. But just because you don't know them doesn't mean you can't feel them. I believe Bronson Pinchot. The Hutchins are in that house, as well as the Enningsons. They've left their imprint on the house where they lived out their lives and died. It is my hope that during the current waiting period, another preservation-minded individual or couple will step forward and offer to purchase the property with the goal of restoring the house and designate it as a local landmark. Bearing all this in mind, I urge the Monrovia City Council to uphold the action of the Historic Preservation Commission and to deny the appeal to change the status of the structure. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anybody else who'd like to speak at this public hearing? Seeing and hearing none, I will close the public hearing.
Mayor, yes. We typically allow a rebuttal.
Oh, yes. I apologize. Mr. Seidner, would you? Okay. Then I will close the public hearing and we'll just go with the council's comments. Yes.
Just have one question for Mr. Jimenez. If we were to redesignate as a, well, not redesignate, but go with a 6L designation, that would eliminate the 120-day waiting period, or there would still be one? It just wouldn't trigger further CEQA action?
The 120 days would continue, and again, until a development project has been approved,
right,
and a building permit is ready to go forward, there would be no demo permit, and that would more than likely take much more than 120 days.
So, but the only... just want to clarify that the only meaningful difference between a 6L designation and a 5S3 is that a 5S3 requires the developer to go through a more extensive CEQA process. Is that the only difference?
Well, it would also mean that a 5S3 would qualify as a historic landmark if the owner so chose. 6L would not.
Right.
And then there would be under CEQA, there would be much more environmental review required.
But the waiting period.
The waiting period doesn't change.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions or comments? Okay, we'll entertain a motion.
I'd like to make a motion that we overturn the Historic Preservation Commission's determination of a 5S3 rating and reassign a rating of 6L.
I'll second that.
Discussion.
You talk about history. Part of this, to me, is very sad because I know we saved this back in 1995 when I believe Larry Ellingson lived there. And I was quite honestly very appalled when I walked in and saw the condition that it was in. And I would love to see somebody save this, but... I do know when I said I've been there many times, I tried to sell it myself to someone who would try to restore it and could not get any interest in that whatsoever. And I was just looking, it was on the market for almost 4 months at a time when things were selling in about 3 weeks. So although I would love to see someone save it, I just don't think it's practical. And it's just a shame that it's been left in such disrepair. I wish there was something we could do for that.
I would agree with that. It's very sad. And it's a question of what it, would it be restored to? It's been changed so many times.
Right. And that is the question. What do you save?
Mm-hmm. I'd just like to point out here that, you know, my motion doesn't actually change the waiting period. Mm-hmm. Right. So there would still be the
chance.
There would still be the opportunity for a historic preservation-minded person to come mm-hmm. along and buy it. So yeah. I feel that making Mr. Seidner go through additional CEQA steps would be merely punitive and wouldn't actually further the cause of historic preservation at all. And I just don't agree with that.
for my part, I don't like to take positions that our commissions and boards have made and overturn them. It's something that I don't readily wish to do. But I do have to say, I do agree with changing and having this to the staff report of the 6L. I think, and I appreciate the Historic Preservation Commission's lengthy discussion on this and thoughtful discussion regarding it, as I appreciate Mr. Baker's comments, and I certainly agree with that. But at the same time, I struggle with this integrity issue, and I struggle with the inability of this property to really have a full identity. And I think because it has been changed so many times, it's hard to determine what is the historical identity here. And should Mr. Seidner decide, you know, that he wants to undertake this project and restore it, I don't know what he would be restoring it to. The original, the colonial, what is the true historic nature of this building? I think because of that, I tend to agree with staff that it really falls under the 6L versus the 5 S3 or S1 or any of the categories in 5, because it is truly one of those issues where you can't identify clearly what it is. And so I do concur with the motion as well. If there are no other comments, we will have, we'll take a vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And opposed?
No.
Okay.
One opposed.
We have Mr. Spicer has opposed. Okay, this motion does carry. Thank you very much, and thank you for the thoughtful discussion. It's very much appreciated. Our next item is Public Hearing on Historical Landmark, HL 128 Mills Act, MA 119, for the property located at 201 Acacia Avenue. And Craig Jimenez will give us this report as well.
And this is a much more positive report. The house at 201 Acacia was built in 1928. The house has many classic elements of an English Tudor, including the typical steep pitch roof, the front-facing gable with the decorative half timbers, the tall divided light casement windows. There's a very nice entry into the porch with a brick trim, as well as one of the primary features of the front elevation, which is the chimney with a random brick placement accents. The historic preservation ordinance requires that the property meet at least one of the 7 criteria in order to be designated a local landmark. The Historic Preservation Commission determined that the property meets criteria number 4, and that the house has several distinct characteristics of English Tudor architecture, and the house retains integrity in its design, materials, and workmanship. The applicant is also requesting approval of a Mills Act contract, which will provide a reduction in property tax for the homeowner. The house is in excellent condition from public view, and if granted a Mills Act contract, the set standards and conditions will be applied to the contract, which include placement of a historic plaque on the house and a electrical safety inspection within 2 years. There are some additional requirements that were placed on by the Historic Preservation Commission as a recommendation. Let me run through the pictures. You can see here on the south elevation, there's a air conditioning unit that's been placed, and also on the north elevation there's an air conditioning unit that's been placed. The commission did recommend a condition that these air conditioning units be removed within 4 years. Also, the driveway is in need of repair, and that the driveway needs to be repaired or replaced within 4 years. There is no fiscal impact associated with the approval of a historic landmark designation. However, as a result of the approval of a Mills Act contract, the estimated reduction in the city's portion of the property tax revenues will be approximately $500 a year. At their meeting of April 24th, 2013, The Historic Preservation Commission voted to recommend approval to the City Council of Historic Landmark Designation and of the Mills Act contract. That concludes my staff report.
Craig, can you go back to that front shot of the house, please?
Yeah, right there.
I was just trying to figure out where the campaign signs were. maybe John could tell us during the testimony.
Any other questions?
Yes, I have a question. In terms of maintenance, what does the Mills Act require, and how, if the homeowner does not maintain the property in a certain way, what happens, and when does it happen, what's the process?
The contract is a 10-year contract. It renews itself every year. So unless one party, either the city or the homeowner, cancels the contract, it basically runs in perpetuity. There are conditions of approval on the contract. A historic landmark does not have any conditions of approval. It's the Mills Act contract that has those conditions. And there are some standard conditions as far as maintenance, maintaining the view from public corridor. If a house is felt by staff or by the Historic Preservation Commission to be in disrepair, then that comes back to the commission, and they can reconsider the contract and make a recommendation to the City Council that the contract be rescinded. Most homeowners of historic properties are very proud of their houses, and that doesn't happen, but there is provision.
I don't anticipate that it would in this case. I need to ask.
Sure.
Or in addition to Mr. Jimenez's point, the Mills Act contract also provides the city the legal and equitable remedy of specific performance in litigation to enforce the maintenance provisions of the agreement.
Right.
So in a worst case scenario, we can go and get an injunction to enforce the maintenance provisions that are in the agreement itself.
Thank you.
Because a topic has come up, have there been any homes that have gotten the Mills Act approval that have dropped off?
No. We had one property that canceled their contract because they found it no benefit to them, but then came back before they sold the property and reapplied for and got the Mills Act contract.
And if, correct me if I'm wrong, we have about 100 homes now that have been Mills Act?
We have 117 Mills Act contracts and 127 historic landmarks.
And for purposes of disclosure on that, the city, it's about 1,000. In our conversation, you indicated that it's about $1,000 a year that we lose on property tax, approximately over. Is it
per? Well, every property is different,
you were averaging.
The right now, I think as of last year's tax assessments, the Mills Act reduction in revenue to the city was about $120,000. So yes, roughly about $1,000 per. View average, and most property owners are seeing about a 50% reduction in their property tax.
Any other questions? Okay, we will open the public hearing and first see if the applicant would like to speak regarding the
application. Do I need to say something first?
Yes. While they're coming up, Councilmember Shevlin has a
I was a docent on the Mother's Day tour, and John and Katie's home was the home where I was the docent. And I could give you a nice dissertation about the front living room, but I know the home well and have toured it extensively and was the docent there on Mother's Day.
And to piggyback on that, I was a tour-y. I did take the tour of the Mother's Day and of this home as well, prior to knowing it was coming before us, but I have taken the tour, of which, if you've been on the Mother's Day tour, you know that there's a lot of discussion about the historic nature of the house and the elements, very similar to what we received in our staff report. So, yes, Ms. Watson.
Good evening. Mayor Lutz and council members, it's a pleasure to be here this evening and to speak about this home. Something that Mr. Baker said earlier resonates with me and with our neighbors as well about this home. We strongly feel that the building has its own life. We are only its caretakers, and we're very proud of it. Due to the windstorm, thank you very much, Mother Nature, of December 2011, We had some damage to the roof, and so last year undertook replacing the roof, and one thing led to another. It's the old story of change a doorknob and rebuild the house kind of thing. So we did a lot of work with it, keeping in mind what Mrs. Roberts, the original owner of the home, would have thought, what would she have been doing, what would be her feeling in the house. We're very proud of many things that are inside the house as well, fixtures, Batchelder fireplace, many things like that that are original to the home. We know some of our neighbors knew Mrs. Roberts, who lived there until she died, and knew what the house looked like inside. It's very little changed inside, and we've tried to maintain the integrity outside. We're proud to be its caretakers and hope that you recognize also its value to the city. There are not many Englishes like this in the city, and so we hope that you would approve that we keep it as a shining example for Monrovia.
Thank you. I do not have any speaker cards. Is there anybody who would like to speak on this item in the public hearing? Seeing and hearing none, I will close the public hearing at this time and allow council to discuss and or make a motion.
I'm gonna just say that after extensive consideration, I think that's a Spicer sign. See, it's got a little like color in the corner there.
Well, thanks, for sure it's not yours.
Yeah.
And with that, I'd like to make a motion. Should I go?
Second.
Yeah, go ahead. We'll go ahead and read the motion so we are clear on what your motion is.
I make a motion to adopt resolution number 2013-23 and approve the Mills Act contract with property owners at 201 Arcasia Avenue.
Second.
Any further discussion?
I just want to say, I think this is really an example of what we meant when we, the Plan Monrovia, the type of homes that we want to preserve. The other home on Lemon was from the street. I have to admit, when I drove up, I went, wow. But then at closer inspection, the integrity just wasn't there. But this is a lovely, a beautiful home, and I hope it can be saved for many years.
Absolutely. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. Congratulations.
Thank you.
This is Mills Act number 119, which is very exciting for our city. Great. Okay, we have one more public hearing this evening. It is public hearing number 3, tentative tract MAC TTM072241, conditional use permit for a 21-unit planned unit development. And I believe before we get started, Mr. Steele has a task at hand.
I have a conflict of interest with the applicant.
As well as I do.
Yeah, I believe that I have a conflict of interest with not Mr. Bowden or his company, but with First Lutheran.
So, three members of the City Council having conflicts of interest on this particular item. Councilmember Shevlin and Adams with the developer, and Councilmember Blackburn with the property owner, being a past client of his law firm. It's that magical time of the evening when we get to invoke what we call the rule of legally required participation. Because only two members of the council are legally qualified to act on the application, we need three to make a decision. And so the Political Reform Act allows for the random choice of one of the conflicted council members to participate in the decision, because there is no other body of the city, obviously, that is able to make this decision. We can't defer it to somebody else. So as is the tradition in the city, we're going to draw coffee straws, and the drawer of the short straw will participate in the decision.
It's our very scientific process here.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Junior member can go first.
Oh, wow.
That looks pretty long.
That would be the short straw.
Oh.
That one is?
Shevlin just drew.
We've got to hold it up.
No, I've never doubted you. I appreciate that.
Well, maybe that one time.
Yeah.
So Councilmember Shevlin is chosen to at random to
participate. Okay. So we will excuse Councilmembers Blackburn and Adams. Mr. Jimenez.
Good evening once again. This is a request to construct a 21-unit planned unit development on the southern portion of a property at 1323 South Magnolia Avenue. Property is currently developed with a church and a private school. Residential development will be is proposed to be on the southern portion of this property. There are several entitlements that are before the City Council tonight. Each requires separate action by the Council. First is the adoption of a negative declaration pursuant to CEQA, California Environmental Quality Act. Also, a change in the land use designation of the general plan for the portion of a property from public, quasi-public, to residential high density. Also, a zone change on a portion of the property from PQP to RH, and finally, approval of a tentative tract map and a conditional use permit for the development. Parcel is located on the west side of South Magnolia Avenue. This is the zoning map for the area, and the subject property is the tan property right here in the middle of the mustard and the yellow, which are both residential zones. The site is 4.4 acres and is currently, as I stated before, developed with a church and a school. The surrounding land uses are all residential, multifamily. This is all the RH zone, residential high density, surrounds the site. Across the street on Magnolia is the RM, residential medium density 3500, which is developed primarily with one and two on a lot. But again, surrounding here, you've got some apartments and some much higher density development. This is an aerial, and you can see the development pattern a little bit better here. This is the subject site right here, and you've got all around here is multifamily residential and lower density residential across the street. This is a close shot of this church property, and you can see in the hatch mark area, this will be the area where the development will be located. It is the southern, this is Magnolia here, so it is the southern portion of the property. It's not quite half the property, it's 1.87 acres. This is the church as seen from Magnolia Avenue. This building will be retained. And this is looking in a northeasterly direction. This is the school portion of the property. This is what will be demolished and replaced with the planned unit development. And then this portion up here will be retained as part of the church. And this is looking the other direction down Magnolia, again looking at the church and the church buildings. And this portion here at the far left will be where the PUD will begin. And this right down the middle here is the dividing line. And so this will be where the new PUD is, and this portion will be retained and part of the church. The site plan shows 21 detached two-story units. Magnolia is down here. They will be served by a common driveway that is a modified U. So there's two access points off of Magnolia. There's a third access point here that will be used solely for emergency access, and will for fire and police department will have a Knox box on it. The development meets all the requirements of the zoning ordinance in regard to setback, building separation, parking, and open space. The units are set back 27 feet from Magnolia and have a nice wide 7-foot porch, so all their front doors will face Magnolia, so we'll interact with the neighborhood, which is a very big component of design review. Trash enclosure is towards the rear. There'll be a single trash enclosure for all the units. Along the side property line, these units are 15 feet from the side property line, 20 feet from the rear property line, and then 15 feet from these additional side property lines, which is what is required by code. The units range in size from 1579 to 1870 square feet in size. And there is also two open parking spaces here and here for a total of 11 guest parking spaces. In addition, each unit provides their own two-car garage. The elevations are a modern craftsman style with a combination of horizontal wood siding and stucco and stone veneer accents. There are tapered columns on the front entry of each unit. And we have a nice rendering up here on the wall that gives you a better idea of what it's going to look. Very attractive. Like I said, a modern craftsman style. From Magnolia, they really do interact well with the street. The general plan amendment and zone change are to accommodate the development. The current zoning of PQP, which is public quasi-public, does not permit residential uses. So in order for the project to go forward, the zone and land use designation in the general plan need to be changed. And we are recommending that it go to an RH zone, which would be consistent with everything else around here. So this portion of the property would be changed to RH and a residential high density designation, and the church property would retain its PQP, public quasi-public designations. Pursuant to the California Environmental Quality Act, an initial study was prepared which analyzed the potential impacts that the proposed project could have on the environment. The initial study did not identify any significant environmental impacts, and therefore a negative declaration is proposed. There was a public meeting that was held by the DRC. We sent out notices because we wanted to make sure that the neighborhood was aware of what was coming forward. We did have several neighbors come and attend and ask questions, and we had a very good discussion with those neighbors, and we seemed to, along with the applicant, alleviate their concerns. We talked about some of the concerns regarding traffic and have forwarded those onto the Traffic Safety Committee for them to review. So with that, we feel that this proposal will be a good addition to this neighborhood, integrating well and providing additional opportunities for Monrovia. Planning Commission, Development Review Committee, and staff are all recommending approval of the project. That concludes my report, and I would be glad to answer any questions.
Any questions of staff?
I was just saying that probably the traffic, I would think if anything there, because the school is no longer there, it's going to be better. People coming and going from work, it's not like kids showing up to work, I mean to school, and then all leaving en masse, coming in and going. So I would think that the traffic patterns would be improved.
You're right. The intensity of the traffic is much different. Residential tends to be much more spread out than a use like a school, which they all come and they all go. Mm-hmm.
But the traffic wasn't that heavy, though, Craig. School, with the school, the traffic wasn't that heavy.
The primary traffic issue is the speeding that's going from Huntington to Central.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right, which is really a different issue that we need to address separately.
Right.
But yeah, I agree. I found that really interesting in the report that the traffic wasn't so heavy, but this change would actually even make it a little easier, which I guess speaks to this development as being something that would add to the neighborhood, not distract. Any other questions? Okay, we will open the public hearing, and first I'll ask if Representative from Bowdoin Development would like to speak.
Good evening, Mayor, and the remaining members of the council. My name is Todd Bowdoin, representing the applicants for the project. As you know, we are co-applicants with the First Lutheran Church, and I'd like to thank them for their cooperation throughout the project. Once again, as with Planning Commission, I'd like to thank staff and Mr. Jimenez for the comprehensive presentation of the project before you this evening. Our project before you provides for much-needed housing in the city and is in close proximity to the Gold Line station. In fact, it's going to be within a very easy walk under the freeway and across Evergreen to the Gold Line station. The development meets and or exceeds all development standards and criteria requirements in the RH zoning, including but not limited to density, open space, setbacks, parking, traffic generation, access, and design. as the RH zone would allow for as many as 45 units based on density alone. We opted to design a detached product that reduces density substantially and offers a complementary transition between the multifamily apartments and condominiums to the south and west, and the church property and PUDs to the north. In closing, I agree with all the conditions of approval imposed on the project, and I would like to once again thank you for considering approval of our project, and I'd be happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Any questions for Mr. Bowden? None this evening.
Thank you.
Thank you. This is a public hearing. Is there anybody else who would like to speak to this item? Seeing and hearing none, I will close the public hearing and allow council to either discuss further or bring a motion.
I'll make a motion to adopt resolution numbers 2013-24, 2013-11, 2013-31, and introduce read by title only and waive further reading of ordinance number 2013-02.
I'll second.
Okay. As far as discussion goes, I'd like to say I appreciate the thoughtfulness in the design with this project, and particularly the units that face Magnolia, in making it a very neighborhood-friendly design. And I do appreciate that you did go over above the amount of space needed for open space. I think that's a very important aspect of our developments, and thank you very much for that, and continuing to bring us projects that really speak to the heart of our community and add to it.
And although it was sad to see the school have to leave, but many of them, if not all, have relocated to another school now, El Monte. But it is sad when a school has to close.
I do agree with you, but I think that if that's going to happen, this seems to be a good resolution for the property
nice
and for the church as well. I think that they'll be getting benefit from this as well. If there's no other discussion, I will ask all in favor.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
And none opposed. This motion carries. Thank you very much.
Mayor, we just need to read.
Yes. Thank you. And now we need to read.
We just need to read ordinance number 2013-02, an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Monrovia, California, adopting zone change ZC 2013-01, amending the official zoning map for the City of Monrovia set forth in section 17.04.040 of Title 17 zoning of the Monrovia Municipal Code to change the PQP public quasi-public zone designation to RH residential high density zone for a portion of the property located at 1323 South Magnolia Avenue.
Thank you. And now if our additional council members will join us, we may need to go knock on the door. Here they come. You okay? Okay, next on our agenda is our city council reports, and we will begin with council member Adams.
Thank you. Nothing too lengthy, but you know, we do a lot of interesting things here in Monrovia. One of the things we do is welcome newborns into town. We mourn the loss of community members, and every now and then we get to celebrate milestones. And on May 26th, Becky, Larry, and myself got to attend Margaret Luter's 100th birthday party up at the Eleven Oaks Hotel. It was a fabulous event, and it's just incredible to see someone who's had such an interesting life be so still full of life at 100 years old. I know she was very appreciative that the city acknowledged her 100th birthday. I know her family was very appreciative of it. I enjoy it thoroughly, and I'm sure you'll hear from Becky and Larry what a nice event it was. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Spicer.
Okay, Mayor. Tonight I'll be providing a brief update on the 38th Annual NUSA Conference, also known as Neighborhood USA.
do something. Mm-mm.
It comes in on it.
Oh. So you're waiting. You're waiting for your PowerPoint to
yes,
come up?
Ma'am.
Oh, okay. Mr. Spicer has a PowerPoint that should be
sorry
coming up.
Sorry for the delay,
soon.
Mayor.
That's all right. Technical difficulties.
Okay, it was truly a pleasure to be able to attend this conference along with our dedicated MAP staff, Sheila, Alfredo, and Heather. The theme of this year's conference was Better Together, which focused on the philosophy of strong neighborhoods make strong cities. This year's event hosted over 200 attendees representing neighborhoods from the USA, Cape Town, South Africa, and Sakura, Japan. This conference continues to be a valuable resource by being able to meet with neighborhood representatives from various backgrounds, cultures, and origins. Regardless of where we are from, NUSA attendees share the common goal in finding solutions to similar problems that plague cities, both large and small. As you know, Mayor and Council, we are looking to enhance and preserve great neighborhoods in our cities. Our previous participation has resulted in producing strong community programs for our residents. Since 2008, Monrovia has been acknowledged by NUSA for different awards, including second place for Best Neighborhood Program, second place for the Best Neighborhood MAP Leadership and Training Academy, third place for the Neighborhood of the Year Social Revitalization Program, which we all know was Sherman Avenue. Silver medal for the Best Neighborhood News Newsletter Award, Who's Who in America's Neighborhood. I don't have to mention
who
the name.
Who is Who's Who? That was Mr. Larry Spicer,
yes.
For everybody who doesn't know.
At this conference, the MAP team and I branched out and found workshops that could best meet our residents' needs. Some of these workshops included partnerships that work when cultural communities and government collaborate, creating a web of opportunities, networks, and relationships for change and equity, backyard to the front porch, plain and simple, how residents took charge of their neighborhoods, mobilizing community change through strategic partnerships, mentoring gang prevention programs, coordinating services for returning ex-offenders. The training of diverse community leaders through the People's Academy for Community Engagement, issues with human trafficking, how it's in your neighborhoods and you don't even know it, engaging tools for engaging renters. Some of the barriers are they don't live in the neighborhood as long as the normal residents. They speak a different language, and some landlords don't want you talking to the tenants. The force behind the change consisted of a tour of North Minneapolis, which was hosted by the Mad Dads. The acronym stands for Men Against Destruction, Defending Against Drugs, and Social Disorder. And I'm just going to give you a little background on the Mad Dads. It was founded in 1989 by a group of concerned men and parents who were fed up with gang violence and the flow of illegal drugs in their community. They presented themselves as positive role models and concerned, loving parents who were a visible presence in communities against the negative forces destroying children, families, and neighborhoods. Mad Dad started out as the pain of children dying in the streets of their own communities. They were and still are tired of looking into the hollow eyes of youth who lack hope and who have ceased to dream. These men realized that they would hold no one responsible for this but themselves because they had allowed this to happen. So they united as a handful of community fathers who had come to know that they must be the force behind the change. A change is already taking place across America as men began monumental tasks of rescuing their children, families, cities from drugs, gangs, and violence. At long last, men are coming to the forefront of the battle. Mad Dad's activities are designed to promote, demonstrate positive images of fathers engaging and protecting communities, youth, and families. The NUSA conference continues to give cities and neighborhood organizations the educational networking opportunities that work to strengthen a city's quality of life through community participation. By bringing these tools to our residents and neighborhoods, we can continue to work to provide the best possible links between city services, neighborhoods, and community organizations. I am proud to say that our small city has been able to create programs from the spirit and essence of NUSA, such as annual neighborhood conference, adult youth leadership academy, quarterly educational meetings for our neighborhood leaders, and community outreach to our residents and neighborhood. These programs have quickly become a staple in our communities. At this time, I would like to introduce our MAP team members, Heather Alfredo, who will be providing information on Monrovia's MAP Neighborhood Conference 2013.
Okay. More technical.
Again?
Where does this go?
It's time for the 4th Annual MAP Neighborhood Conference. At the conference, you'll enjoy free food and entertainment, as well as 21 workshop options, including emergency preparedness, environmental services, bully prevention, and community event planning, as well as a bus tour with Mayor Lutz and much, much more. The conference is on Saturday, August 10th at Monrovia High School from 9:30 a.m. to 3 p.m. The event is completely free of charge and open to the public. To register by Thursday, August 1st, visit the event website at cityofmonrovia.org or contact Monrovia's Neighborhood Services Division at 626-932-5563. See you there!
Well, good evening, Mayor and City Council. I'm Heather Greer, and I'm joined here tonight by Neighborhood Services staff and representing the Monrovia Area Partnership. And we're here tonight to invite you and the entire community to the 4th Annual MAP Neighborhood Conference. As you learned in our video, the MAP Neighborhood Conference is an all-day event, open to the public and free of charge, and it's going to be full of festivities and food and incredible workshops and great Monrovia residents. And the purpose of this event truly is to bring people together, partner people, passion, and resources so that we can build a stronger Monrovia. A lot of what you'll see at our neighborhood conference is inspired from the Neighborhoods USA conference that we attend every year. But the difference, what makes our conference unique, is that MAP element, the partnership. This neighborhood conference is not just hosted for the community, but it truly is hosted by the community. Everything from the video to the flyer, the instructors, the food, and even the facility have been donated to this event, which is truly inspiring because it's we see that MAP does not just invest in the community, but the community truly is investing back in the program because they've seen the difference that it's made in their lives and in their neighborhoods. This year we're hosting, I almost said 32, 23 workshops, which is nearly double our 12 from last year. These workshops are going to be hosted and facilitated by by city staff, by city officials, by community leaders, and field professionals. And again, all of these workshops, all of these facilitators are donating their time and expertise for the value of community education. Something else that I would like to highlight, new to this year's conference, is workshops in Spanish. Yes.
Great.
So
this
just further speaks to how much can be accomplished when the community takes their passion and their expertise and bring it back into the community. Because these workshops, as well as the outreach to the Spanish-speaking community, is being done through a community group who came to us and said, we would love to see this happen this year. And so we're really happy to be facilitating that at our conference, and it's being led by the community. This is more than an event. It just is. This is so much bigger than an event because it has such lasting results. The MAP program and this day of togetherness empowers people, and empowered residents are the cornerstone and the foundation of not just a strong community, but a sustainable community. And so before I tell you how to register and we sign off, I did want to invite up a resident, a MAP neighborhood leader, who attended the conference last year and who is a living testament to these long-term results that we see from this program. This is Malika Robinson-Butler.
I don't know. Practice.
Thank you, Heather. Thank you, Mayor Lutz and the City Council members. First, I don't know why I'm nervous. I have formally met you all, and you guys are so wonderful. You've been to my church. You know, I'm sorry. I don't mean to be so nervous, but I just like to say thank you for allowing me this opportunity to tell you about my great experiences that I have had since coming to the neighborhood conference. I think that is when I have started to get to know each and every one of you, and had some type of experience with you all. First of all, I was invited to be a part of this neighborhood conference by Chaplain Brown, which is also a member of my church. He invited the members of our church to attend, which included myself, my mom, and my aunt. We loved it. It was absolutely wonderful. We are four generations of Monrovia, and we had no idea what Monrovia had to offer. We just were clueless. The people are wonderful. The workshops were great. They were informative. They were fun. They were exciting, interesting. Me and my mom were just walking around, just looking at all the, you know, the different booths and talking to people, networking. We had a great, great time. It also motivated me to, it opened a window of opportunity for me to volunteer and to be a part of other committees within Monrovia. Me and my aunt actually signed up to be part of the Monrovia Area Partnership Leadership Academy, which we both attended and graduated following that neighborhood conference. And after that, I was afforded the opportunity to attend City Clerk Alice Atkins' class on how to run for city office, which I thoroughly enjoyed. It was a great opportunity where I got to talk to Mr. Adams, rub elbows, and get some pointers on that. So that was really, really interesting. I learned a lot of information. I've always wanted to be a part of maybe the school board or something like that. You know, I'm just interested in, you know, something I've always showed an interest in. I'm a part of the core team for the Youth Development Committee. I've also taken a mentoring class with Ms. Shelvin that was offered by Susan Hirsch, which now has given me the skills to help with the Youth Leadership Academy, the core team that my son is also a soon-to-be graduate this 18th of the second annual youth leadership. So my family's involved. I'm involved. I'm constantly looking for more ways to be involved with this community. I love it. Absolutely love it. I had no idea what was in store for me. I look forward to future endeavors things that I can be a part of, anything you need me to do, volunteer, I'm the one. Thank you so much.
Is that it?
That was great. Our hope is that that is every Monrovian story, that everyone who is touched by the MAP program, everyone who attends one of these events and gets to meet with other passionate residents, walks away saying, this community really needs me and I really have something to offer. So thank you so much for sharing, Malika, and so register today. If that wasn't reason enough, I don't know what was. You can register online at cityofmonrovia.org. You can always call Neighborhood Services at 626-932-5525, where not only can you register by phone, but if you want to talk to us about sponsorship opportunities or volunteer opportunities, we'd be happy to discuss that as well. You can also register on-site at City Hall, Community Center, or the library, where paper forms will be available in English and Spanish. And in upcoming weeks, we will also have mobile registration sites. So there will be a banner telling you how to register, along with a computer, and you can register right then and there. In the upcoming months, you'll see banners, you'll see posters, you'll get a notice in your water bill. We might show up at your house. I don't know. You won't be able to escape us. So please share this information with your neighborhood, with your families. Sign up. We are so proud of this event and the community that has come together to make it happen. And we're so proud of this program and happy to be here. Are there any questions about the program before we go or about this event?
Not a question, but a comment, which is the new location this year at the brand new remodeled, yeah, redone high school is a very exciting addition.
It is very exciting. Alfredo Enriquez has been working very closely with Monrovia Unified School District. They've been fantastic. You'll see on the flyer that we have counted them as one of our sponsors because they have been amazing in working with us. But not only that, they are waiving many, many, many rental fees so that we can be there because they believe in this too. And so we're really happy to do that. And it's going to be a great opportunity to highlight that new auditorium as well. It's beautiful.
And I was just going to mention too, last year, for anyone that just thinks it's the same old people that are coming to the same events, there were so many new faces, and it was so refreshing, and people were so excited about getting involved, and they have continued to be involved, and that's another reason why we have to find a way to keep the program going.
And so many more people have been involved just in the planning that we have actually raised our expected attendance 50% from last year.
And last year was pretty good.
Yes, it was.
So thank you, Heather. Thank you, Alfredo,
thank you.
Sheila, Communities Development Director Steve. And also, I wanted to elaborate on what Mr. Adams was talking about in regards to the birthday party. Man, for a young lady turning 100 years old, my God, and to be able to stand up, hold a microphone, and share her memories. Now tell me, that's a blessing. With that, Mayor, that's the end of my report.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for giving us all the information on your trip that you took. It was, sounds like it was very worthwhile.
It was excellent, Mayor.
Great. Councilmember Blackburn.
I don't have anything specific to reports. I'd just like to thank Councilman Spicer for taking the time out of his life to go attend this conference and for bringing back, I'm sure, knowledge that was gained there that can be put to use here in Monrovia. And so that's all I'd like to say.
Thank you.
Thank you. I mean, Councilmember Al.
Mayor Pro Tem Shevlin.
Thank you. Yes, and 11 Oaks was packed. They had that place packed with party goers, and she was, Margaret was really impressive, and she looked really nice in her pretty pink dress, and it was a very nice event. Well, summer is now upon us, and I believe I announced last meeting, but I will again this meeting, that the library is starting their summer reading club, Dig Into Reading. So come on, bring the kids down and register at the library. It begins June 10th, or you can call the library. But stop on by, and it's a lot of fun. Great times. People getting involved. And the Friends of the Monrovia Library are having their half price book sale throughout the month of June. Come and buy a great book. And community services, like they mentioned earlier, was having their registration. Are you topped out? There's still room. City is having the community services, their summer extravaganza recreation program this summer, and registration started today. But the program runs from June 24th to August 16th. From noon to 5 p.m., and it's open to Monrovia residents 6 years to 16 years of age, and it's free of charge who meet the income qualifications. I also wanted to mention that our Friday night wildlife program, or it's not ours, but it's in our library park, it starts Friday, June 14th, and runs for 8 weeks to August 2nd, and it's from 6:45 to 9:30 p.m. At Library Park. Come out, and it's for
middle-aged teenagers.
For middle school and high school age youth, and come out for the food, fun, and fellowship. They have lots of good music and food, and lots of activities for the kids on Friday nights, so be sure to come out for that. And don't forget our summer concerts are starting up at July 7th, and there'll be 8 concerts. And our fireworks on the 4th. And there's still time, if you would like to donate to the cause, you can donate to the great fireworks show. But remember that we are having that here in our downtown, Old Town, at the Library Park on July 4th. And congratulations to all those graduates out there. Thank you.
Thank you. Benjamin Moore Paints is having a contest, and we are in it. The contest is to paint a downtown, or in our case, an old town. We are one of 6 or 7 California cities that is in the contest, the only city in Southern California. You have to vote for us to win this contest, in which they will paint our old town, or portions of it, probably not the whole thing. But at any rate, this is a great opportunity for us to put a new facelift on our city. So how do you vote? This is how you vote. You go to www.paintwhatmatters.com, and then follow the instructions and vote for the city of Monrovia. If you don't live in Monrovia, you can vote. It doesn't matter where you're from, you can vote. You get to vote every single day until the end of June. I've been trying to figure out how we can see where our votes are. I can't figure that out. It's kind of a secret ballot, I guess, because they're not telling us. But I do know that every day when I vote, I put a notice on Facebook, and people say, I did too, I did too, I did too. So let's catch this like wildfire. Let's vote for Monrovia to get our downtown old town painted. Paintwhatmatters.com. Vote every single day. And I did find out that I could vote once from my computer in my office and once from my computer at my house.
It's like Chicago.
And Mary.
One is mine and one is my husband's.
Okay,
there you go.
Mayor.
Yes.
And when you go, you have to click, it's kind of confusing, and a map will come up. Click on the California on the map, and then it'll take you to the list of ones in California.
Right. The instructions tell you how to process that, and you click California, and then it gives up, either gives you the name of the cities or you bring it up. It depends on whether you're looking from an iPad or a telephone or a computer, but it's fairly simple. You can vote really quick and easy.
It looks like we only have Eureka, Gilroy, Martinez, Placerville, and Old Oakland that we're competing against, so we're not competing against a big list of towns.
No. We should be able to beat them. Vote. Every day. Every day. I will be leaving Monrovia along with our city staff member, Jennifer McLean. Next Tuesday, we will be going to Washington, D.C. to meet with legislators and with some representatives for 2 days, jam-packed full of meetings. We'll be meeting with Congress members, senators' offices, and we'll be talking about such issues as transportation, water, infrastructure, our unfunded mandate that is coming up. We'll be talking to the people who fund the police special programs to try to get them to give us a little more, to find out more about grants that we can apply for our police. And we'll also be talking about something you're going to hear about at the next item, which is the National Recreation Area. So we have 2 days of completely full meetings and agenda, hopefully to there are some new legislators in Washington. We'll be able to meet a couple of new people and to find out information and bring it back so we can move forward in our city. Also, last week I was fortunate to be joined by Mayor Pro Tem Shevlin and our police chief, Jim Hunt, at a legislative meeting hosted by State Senator Carol Liu, State Senator Ed Hernandez. And unfortunately, all of our assembly members were slated to be there, but they were not allowed to leave the assembly chamber to come home. So they had to stay in Sacramento. And the topic was realignment, or for those of you who aren't clear what realignment is, it has to do with the legislation that passed last year for certain prisoners who are nonviolent to be released from our state jails, and the impact that that has had on our cities. And it was a very good, very honest, and frank discussion about what this has meant to our municipalities. Senator Liu afterwards sent a letter remarking about the event and kind of the minutes of the event, and it was very clear that she heard everything that was said. So we're hoping that that will result in some awareness in Sacramento, in the legislature, as to what this means and how maybe they can help us live with the decision that they made for us. So that was a very beneficial meeting. And that is the end of my report this evening. Thank you. Next, we will have our administrative report, and administrative report one is an update on the National Recreation Area designation. Heather Maloney will give us this staff report.
Good evening, Mayor and City Council. This evening's report's purpose is to provide a general overview of the proposed National Recreation Area designation that's been going on in our region, particularly for the San Gabriel Mountains and the San Gabriel and Rio Hondo River areas. And this evening we have Adon Ortega here with us. He has become an expert in the National Recreation Area. I'm going to call you an expert because I'm quite impressed with his knowledge on this subject. But because of that, he's been retained by the San Gabriel Valley Water Association to advocate for water for the water industry's perspective on this National Recreation Area. So later on in the presentation, he's going to be providing specific comments and concerns from the water industry and sharing that. But first of all, we'll jump into just some quick background on the National Recreation Area. These are kind of some definitions that I'll be using throughout the presentation, so I'm just going to overview what these are. The National Recreation Areas combine scarce open spaces with preservation of significant historical resources and important national natural areas. And for the most part, they aim to focus on locations that provide outdoor recreation to large numbers of people. And then they're most of the time they're centered around some kind of water recreation opportunity or large reservoirs. And then these this actual designation requires an act of Congress. So this is a federal designation. And then the next item here, which is a wilderness area designation, is this is permanent protection for wilderness areas. And it's one of the highest forms of federally protected land in the country. And those are generally pure wilderness areas, no roads, no development, and very restricted recreation opportunities are provided, such as hiking, biking, but no motorized sports, things like that are allowed in these wilderness areas. And then the next background definition is the National Wild and Scenic Rivers Act. And these are this act was established to preserve rivers that possess outstanding, remarkable scenic, recreational, geological, fish, wildlife, historic, cultural, and other similar values. And they're really meant to preserve the rivers in their free-flowing form. So you can see a picture up there on the top. That's of McLeod River, and it's beautiful, scenic, free-flowing form. And then it's contrasted kind of with some of our local water bodies. But the flows in these scenic, wild and scenic rivers are not supposed to be dammed or otherwise impeded at all. So these are three different designations that are being discussed kind of all at once. And so I'm gonna try and define kind of where they each come into play with this study area. So to start off, this whole discussion really started off back in the early 2000s regarding a national recreation area designation for our area here in the San Gabriel Valley and in the related mountain area. So this picture here shows the original study area that the National Park Service undertook. It encompassed 700 acres of land within, including the Angeles Forest area that's to the east of us, and the entire urban interface with the forest, as well as the river and some of the Puente Hills area. So once the study came back, their goal was to establish where within that whole study area would be appropriate to establish a national recreation area. And the recommendations that came back were that the National Forest Service the National Forest Area should remain under the control of the Forest Service. And then those yellow highlighted areas there on the lower portion of the map, so are basically our urban interface with the forest, the San Gabriel River, the Rio Hondo River, and the Puente Hills would become a unit of a national recreation area. And then instead of being a separate national recreation area, they'd be joined with the Santa Monica Mountains National Recreation Area. But then they'd be covered under the scope of that national recreation area designation. And then on top of this national recreation area designation, several stakeholders have also been encouraging that certain portions of the San Gabriel River be established as wild and scenic, and then also portions of this national recreation area be established as wilderness area. And so those would be additional layers on top of the recreation area that some stakeholders are pushing. The big difference between the wild and scenic and the wilderness area designations is that thus far there's been no specific study like there was done for the national recreation area. And what that study really walks through is, looks at the whole area, looks at what's suitable for that designation, looks at some of the pros and cons, and lists out options for that designation. And these other two designations have not undergone that type of study. It's just really stakeholders pushing for that without that extensive study behind it. And then related specifically to the National Recreation Area designation, there's several local stakeholders that have been working with U.S. Rep. Judy Chu to draft some legislation. So two versions of draft legislation have gone through, Representative Judy Chu is still trying to work with stakeholders to work out some of the interests and concerns that are related to this National Recreation Area designation. So some of the benefits of such a designation would be to, it provides, you know, the region with a much greater amount of recreational opportunities within that designated zone, and then could potentially provide additional resources to further the recreational opportunities and to maintain and operate those as well. Some of the supporters of this designation include the Wilderness Society, Friends of the River, and then we've got some local organizations that are backing this as well, such as Amigos de los Rios and our local Sierra Club. And again, as I mentioned earlier, they've been working with our federal representatives, Judy Chu, and then our Senator Barbara Boxer, who are both interested in sponsoring some form of legislation related to this. And then, you know, we have, aside from some of the stakeholders that I already listed, there's a lot of cities and water agencies and business folks that have started to get engaged in the conversation about this designation. And I haven't heard anybody come out, you know, in opposition to it in those different stakeholder meetings that I've attended. However, there are a lot of concerns that are still left unresolved. And I think people just want to, that from what I've been hearing from stakeholders, is that they want to see these addressed and resolved before they can, you know, really determine if they're going to fully support this or not. And so I'm going to walk through what some of those stakeholder concerns are. The first one is regarding the governance of the recreation area. And there's two kind of major concerns related to governance. One is that the pairing with the Santa Monica Mountains designation area, and that this would, some stakeholders have expressed a concern that that because it would be governed by Santa Monica area, that it wouldn't provide a local perspective from the San Gabriel Valley, and that you know, furthermore, if our local residents or businesses wanted to engage in a process, it would be a long trip clear across the county for them to get engaged, rather than having an oversight committee or an advisory council for our own region here. And then the second concern regarding governance is that there would be a public advisory council that would be set up. This would be a temporary council, but their purpose would be to develop an implementation and implement the management plan for this recreation area. And there's a lot of stakeholders, including cities, the business community, that are really concerned that they don't have adequate representation as outlined in the draft legislation right now to feel like their interests would be heard efficiently or effectively on this board. So I'm hearing a lot of comments from stakeholders, you know, that they want to see more membership representing local interests, such as city and business perspective. And then the next one is local land use control. And this is sort of more of a general statement, and that a lot of these concerns are coming up because the legislation's vague, or it doesn't clarify how these issues are going to be addressed and or resolved. And so there's a lot of what if questions that still need to be answered. And so there's not necessarily answers for them, but it's bringing to light that they need to be addressed in some capacity before stakeholders can get behind this designation. So local land use control, you know, there's a lot of concern that because of the overlay of the federal designation, that there may be some effect on our ability as local agencies to implement our general plans, or even affect some of our environmental regulations as well. And then, you know, on the environmental note for our stormwater permit compliance, because we're looking at water flows that are coming through the National Forest, but also looking at the Rio Hondo and San Gabriel Rivers, which are the receiving waters for our stormwater runoff and what we have all those MS4 permit regulations for, the concern is that we don't fully understand quite yet if there would be an impact adding another layer of regulations on top of that, if it would, you know, affect our ability to install infrastructure near or within the recreation area, and then also maintain that infrastructure. And then furthermore, if there's increased recreation happening within those water bodies, it may cause our our stormwater permit compliance to be more strict because there's more activity and more contact with that water. So that's something that we're trying to kind of figure out if there is going to be an effect or not. And then the next one is related to business concerns. And there's a number of businesses within the San Gabriel Valley that actually have their own specific water rights for their business. And so they're definitely concerned about any impacts to water quality or their water rights. And then in general, the business community is concerned about if this would increase their permitting requirements, such as would they have to go through a NEPA review or the California version of the Environmental Quality Act, if they would have to go through additional reviews or be required to do additional mitigation that they wouldn't have otherwise because their business is going to be within, or that their proposed development is within the recreation area. And then related to fire protection, this is just kind of a question about how particularly the urban interface area of our communities along the foothills, how our local fire prevention and firefighting practices and policies, how that would interact with the Forest Service's kind of let it burn policy. And so, I mean, they have reasons for doing that within the wilderness area, but it doesn't always match up with our goals as a municipality and trying to protect life and property here. So we don't know if there is going to be an issue with that. It's just, that's again, one of those question marks out there. We don't know how it's going to be addressed and how those overlapping authorities would work together to ensure that our interface is protected. And then the last one that I'm going to review is related to local impacts. And this is just in general, that there hasn't been identified quite yet a procedure to identify local impacts such as air quality, traffic, public safety concerns resulting from additional foot and vehicular traffic traveling through our communities to enter into the recreation area. And so cities and other local landowners are asking for a process to be established to identify those and that those concerns would be mitigated through that process. So that that concludes my overview, and I'm going to hand it over to Adon because the water agencies have been highly involved in this process, and I really think these are probably the predominant concerns for our community. So Adon's going to talk with you.
Thank you very much, and good evening, members of the council, Mayor Lutz. It's a pleasure to be here in your beautiful chambers, and you'll be getting some votes from Fullerton for your...
Thank you, Adon.
Paint that.
I knew I could count on you.
Well, people will ask me, where do you live? And I say, well, I live in L.A. County, and I sleep in Orange County, and I spend a lot of time here, so thank you. First, let me see if I know how to turn this. What are we talking about here in terms of drinking water facilities, and why are we so concerned? If you followed, for example, the Integrated Regional Watershed Master Plans, what we call the IRWMP process, you'll notice that over time, many of the plans were about open space, but with a priority on capturing more stormwater and increasing the amount of recycled water that we're using in the region. We find ourselves kind of in an awkward situation because this discussion's kind of flipped the other way, which is how do we, deal with open space, and then water is kind of a component that kind of follows along. So what we did was to do a survey of drinking water facilities within the designation zone, and as Heather outlined, the green area and the yellow area in alternative D is considered the preferred alternative. What you have here with a separate unit along the foothills and the river is what came out of the final report from the National Park Service after review by the Office of Management and Budget. So we're considering the whole thing as though it could be one anyway, because legislatively it may happen. And we identified 320 drinking water facilities in this survey. Monrovia is represented with 13 facilities for drinking water purposes that's within the designation zone. And you can see the high number of wells and reservoirs and treatment facilities and pump and control systems, and future projects, which I think are important when we talk about economic development and growth in this region. The Metropolitan Water District alone identified 600 facilities because of major diameter pipes that convey water from the Colorado River into this region to their Laverne treatment plant. So in sum, we have about 900 drinking water facilities, and this includes everything from manhole covers to all of these other facilities that we've identified. We want to make sure that, as Heather expressed, that the access to these facilities, that the quality of the water is not impacted. We've been told repeatedly by proponents and also by Congresswoman Chu's office that they will give us language that is protective of this. And so we're in the process of developing that language in the coming weeks, and we'll be ready to share it with you. But a key component of that language is, how do you deal with water rights? And if the forest area in the current report stays as part of the National Forest Service, it's kind of a straightforward answer, because what you could do is simply ask the Forest Service to continue with the practice of working under the State Water Resources Control Board in the allocation of their water rights. And what do we mean by that? Say the Forest Service, the Park Service says to the Forest Service, you know, we want 200 acre feet for kayaking to be released of your water rights. Well, for us, the concern is the timing of that release and whether it will obstruct other flows from being introduced into the groundwater basin instead of flowing out into the ocean. Well, in a state water resources control board process, we would have, you know, two processes in to be able to rely on. But, you know, we're concerned that many water systems draw water from all or mostly from wells in this region. In the San Gabriel River, I realize that you discharge into the Rio Hondo, but in the San Gabriel River, we capture about 95% of the flows already. Wells provide water that seeps from the San Gabriel River, and then also there's recycled water. And few people know that without the use of stormwater and recycled water and imported water combined, we wouldn't be able to introduce a lot of groundwater into the basin. For example, recycled water alone would be too salty. So we really need to have the flexibility in the operations to introduce these different sources of water. If local water supplies are insufficient, it may very well be that you retain your water rights, but if there's less water in the basin and in the groundwater basin, you're going to be able to pump less, and that's just the simple reality. Lost supplies may be replaced with increasingly unreliable and expensive imported water. And that has land use consequences, as Heather related, because we have, for example, in the Bay Delta, a new body that's kind of like the Coastal Commission called the Bay Delta Stewardship Council, and they've claimed jurisdiction over any land use decisions in California where the land use results in an increase in reliance on imported water. So if the case could be made by someone that says, hey, you know, all of a sudden this water isn't available, you know, this city has a general plan and an urban water management plan, and they're going to tap more imported water, that would put the whole development question in the hands of another state agency, which would be something new to this region. So we want to not turn the clock back and make sure we retain all the water that we have. Our position is that we have no objection to the National Recreation Act designation as long as water flows and water rights and water quality and facilities are protected for current and future needs. We have a position that we would like to see a technical review body and process before recreational projects are approved. The partnership, which is the main governance body, is for those that have property that they administer in the designation area, as well as responsibility for budgeting recreational activities. We don't believe that belongs in the purview of your ratepayers. Additional request is, as Heather related, that wild and scenic and wilderness areas require a separate set of studies before they're introduced in legislation. And like I said, we're going to be introducing language fairly soon. So my bosses in this are Tony Zampiello and Wendy Law over at the San Gabriel Valley Water Association. If you have any questions or need materials, we've supplied more, I think, materials than anybody really wants, but they're there for the taking for any of the members of the association of which you are. So thank you very much. I'm very happy to be here tonight.
Thank you.
And then lastly, I just wanted to highlight some opportunities that are coming up for stakeholder involvement. A lot of these are actually geared toward elected officials, but certainly open to community members that may want to get involved as well. Our U.S. Rep. Judy Chu will be hosting 4 roundtable discussions throughout the month of June. I believe the first one was hosted last week. And those are really meant, I think she was focusing a few of them on, particularly on the water concerns that Mr. Ortega outlined, but certainly you're covering some of the other issues related to the recreation area designation. And then the San Gabriel Valley Water Master is hosting a meeting actually tomorrow morning about this specific issue. And then the San Gabriel Valley Council of Governments has expressed some interest in getting involved in this as well to represent the municipal perspective in our region. There's going to be presentations to the City Manager's Technical Advisory Committee this month, as well as a presentation that will be going on at the Governing Board meeting, at the COGS Governing Board meeting. And then I believe that those discussions are going to be overviewing the recreation area, but also talking about the possibility of the COG hosting a workshop for elected officials and other city officials and community members that are interested, and then possibly setting up a subcommittee to really focus in on the municipal perspective of this issue. So those are some opportunities that are coming up in the near future. We're continuing to track the stakeholder discussions as much as we can so that we can report back to you the progression of this issue, and then certainly as more opportunities to get involved come up, we will make sure that the council and the community is aware of those opportunities. So at this time, this concludes my presentation, and if you have any questions for Don or I, we'd be happy to address them.
A couple. I'm just wondering, in the meetings you attend, when they start to talk about letting the rivers go back to being wild and scenic again, has anyone brought up any photos or discussion about, I know in Monrovia, I think the big flood here was 1933, I think, which is why they didn't want the rivers to be wild anymore.
Azusa,
I think it was 1969 when most of North Azusa was covered with about 4 feet of mud and boulders. And so a lot of these things have been changed to protect us, and I'm just curious about the movement to unchange that.
I'll let Don elaborate here because he's been studying this issue a little bit more, but I believe the wild and scenic designation right now in the discussions is only pertaining to one specific area of the San Gabriel River, which is up more in the wilderness area already. Okay. And I'll let you elaborate.
That's a very good question, because one of the major players here is the County Flood Control District, and they're very concerned about maintaining access. We've had some fires that have created some very challenging sediment removal challenges in the area, and if we're going to be able to control those floods over the long term and then properly manage flows for water supplies, those sediments are going to have to be removed. And if you have recreational activities that impede access to these facilities during certain times of the year, it could present problems. County Flood Control has suggested language that would address that, but that's in stakeholder legislation, and we'll have to wait to see if it's accepted by the Congresswoman.
And then one more question, if I may, about water rights. I know the majority of the land that Monrovia purchased for the Wilderness Preserve came with deeded water rights. In addition to that, there are 3 homeowners that use spring water that have deeded water rights, and that spring, I think, is located up on federal land, and there's probably not too many people that know that. But if someone comes through and starts manipulating water rights, I think we need to make certain that those folks are protected.
Sure.
Yes, I think I think that's another very prudent comment. I know that in the stakeholder discussions, we've asked whether anybody plans to contact people that live adjacent to the river or people that live in various segments of the mountain area where they're being appropriated water rights for certain uses. And that's a process that's yet to be determined. We've cited, for example, to the stakeholders, processes like the LA River Revitalization Master Plan, where a significant amount of money was spent reaching out to such people. And I think right now the question is whether they'll have the resources to be able to do that. And just as an aside, Congresswoman Grace Napolitano, whom we met with a few weeks ago, was adamant that we really needed to reach out to folks that live near the river. And we began last week by reaching out to small system water operators. And these are people that have, you know, maybe 100 connections. They're mutual track companies. And we had a workshop for them on this topic. So maybe it'll fall on us to do some of that.
Okay. Thank you very much. Nice report. Thank you. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Yes. The San Gabriel Watershed and Mountains, Mountains Special Resource Study advocates a recreation area of only about 50,000 acres. What do you think? Do you have a comment on that? One-tenth the size of the 581,000.
I think, is that Plan D?
Yeah, part of Plan D.
Plan D.
Yeah.
I'm not sure about that, but I'd be happy to look into that one for you. Yeah.
They evaluated a number of different alternatives, mm-hmm. and most of the alternatives had an overlapping designation over some of the federally designated Forest Service area. So I think this designation actually maybe covers the smallest area, but it may potentially have some of the bigger impacts to the local jurisdictions in that surround that zone. I think that this has the potential to have some very meaningful long-term impacts to us if it's not done properly. It could be very detrimental to our own local control efforts and to being able to preserve some of our things that we've worked really hard to acquire, the water situation, the open space area, and our recreational designations to that. But I think that the potential impacts have yet to really fully been vetted, and so we wanted to make sure that the council was aware of this proposal so that you were also able to communicate in the community what some of the downsides may be as well as mm-hmm. the upside.
What are the chances that we can still keep local control, or what are the chances, I guess I should say, of the Santa Monica Mountain Conservancy taking over?
Do you want me to cover that one?
Yeah.
This has been a topic that has been under discussion with the San Gabriel Valley Council of Governments for since the onset, actually, and they did support in concept this, and now that some things have changed recently with it, as Council Member Spicer mentioned, he spoke to one of the alternatives that it looked like was moving forward, but when we got this last report, it flipped it very different than what anybody was expecting. So because it was flipped different, we were all working in one way to get, because we thought it would be designated in one manner and trying to get language that would do what we felt would protect all of us and all of our rights and the water rights and the property rights and everything. And then with this flip, at first, Congressmember Chu said, well, she didn't like it. And since her staff has said, you know, that they really feel that whatever the legislation is, it's going to carry the day, regardless of what the recommendation has been. So it's possible that she'll go back to that concept that everybody seemed a little more comfortable with, which was Plan D, if you read your report. But one of the points that is, I think, one of the biggest sticking points right now is that this new plan ties us with the Santa Monica Mountains Conservancy and actually gives them oversight over this land. And to a person, in every meeting I've been in, that's a point of no return. And so I think we're going to hear tomorrow at this meeting some more discussion about that. But Congresswoman Chu's staff heard that loud and clear. So it is possible that, you know, it really is going to depend on the legislation. And this is one of the things that we've been saying is in concept, there's a lot of positives for this, but the proof is going to be in the pudding, and it's how it's going to be written in the legislation as to whether it'll be beneficial or not. So this is our time to work with the Congresswoman while she's writing the legislation to make sure that everything that we feel needs to be in there to protect us and our rights and what we feel is the right manner in which this should be done, that it does get done in that manner. So that's one of the reasons why Heather and Adon are talking about this, so that everybody gets on the same page. And we talked about the fact that there are some communities that this isn't on their radar at all, even though they're in the interface and it's going to go right through their sit there, because it goes down the river. If you saw the map, it the Emerald Necklace that we've all been talking about for many years for recreation, it's part of this plan now. So it goes through many municipalities, and some of them are not really even aware because that part is, it's not been fully discussed. So this is our opportunity to have our voices heard. And like I said, I think that that is a non-starter, the San Gabriel Mountains. Santa Monica Mountains, having jurisdiction over this. I think that you'll see, if that continues, if it looks like it's going to be in the legislation, you're going to see major opposition.
Now, Mayor, is that only with the scaled-down version? That it would be
yes,
part
it did.
Of the
it was not in Plan D. It was not. That was the biggest surprise of the new version that mm-hmm. came out, or the recommendation that came out, that it that was one of them. And I think I can understand maybe possibly why Washington, D.C. and the bigger organizations see that as a very big organization that could handle all the everything that would come forward. However, they don't know anything about San Gabriel Valley. They don't. We have a very different watershed. We have a very different situation here than what they have in Santa Monica. And we reserve the right to be able to have some control of our local areas, and that's where I think the rubber's going to meet the road. So, thank you very much. Thank you for a very informative report, and we'll move forward.
Thank you.
Thank you. This does conclude our city council meeting for this evening. Our next city council meeting will be June 18th in these chambers at 7:30. We have been, for the last couple of weeks, holding special study sessions regarding our budget. We held a meeting on May 29th and a meeting earlier today, and there will be one more meeting to come before we adopt our budget. So please look for that and tune in to hear what's happening with your budget here in the city of Monrovia. But our next council meeting will be June 18th, 7:30 in these chambers. And with that, we are adjourned.